We at the National Post have long taken the controversial stance that communism is a bad idea. They build sucky cars, they have an annoying habit of starving millions of people to death, and whenever you cut a country in two and make one side communist, that side always seems to become the crappy side. But despite its many unspeakable failures, there is one solitary category in which communist countries have utterly mopped the floor with the capitalist world. I'm talking about the Olympic Games. The Soviet Union only started showing up to the Olympics in the 1950s. Before then, they thought athletic competition was too bourgeois. They would compete in only 18 games before the country's collapse in 1991. At 13 of those 18 games, the Soviet Union was the number one medal contender. At the other five, they were number two. To this day, the USSR has won more gold medals and more Olympic medals total than any other country except the United States. And the United States has been sending athletes to the Olympics for 86 years longer than the Soviets. And that's not all. East Germany, which never had more than 18 million people, beat the United States at six Olympics. At the 1984 Winter Games, they even ranked number one in gold medals. The 1988 Seoul Olympics occurred just a year before the fall of the Berlin Wall. Look at the medal tally. In a distant first place is the USSR, then East Germany, and here you have the communist nations of Hungary, Bulgaria, and Romania utterly spanking the much larger and much richer countries of Italy, France, and the UK. So clearly, following the tenets of Marx turns one's nation into a land of athletic supermen, right? Not exactly. One critical thing to remember is that prior to the mid-1980s, the Olympics only allowed amateur athletes, which is to say, athletes who had never been paid to compete. So that means no NBA players in the basketball events, no NHLers in the hockey events, no English Premier League players in the soccer events. Well, Muhammad Ali won a gold medal at the 1960 Olympics soon after graduating high school. But as soon as he went professional, his Olympic days were over. Mark Spitz was a student at Indiana University during his Olympic heyday. You can see why the amateurs only rule would be great for communist countries. First of all, they don't have to worry about losing their top athletes to professional sports leagues. You get shot if you try to leave the country. Second of all, the Warsaw Pact nations quickly adopted a very tenuous definition of what amateur meant. Soviet athletes were all technically given straight government jobs. The members of the famed Soviet Olympic hockey team, for instance, were ostensibly officers in the Red Army. But in practice, communist Olympians trained full-time and were elevated to the elite of Soviet society. The Soviet Olympic high jumper Valery Brumel, for instance, was allowed to drive a Volga sedan, a rare privilege afforded to only the top tier of Soviet apparatchiks, particularly in the 1960s. And since we're talking about the Soviet bloc here, their Olympic strategy also involved a fair amount of reckless endangerment. Remember that powerhouse East German team? It turns out that government spent several decades injecting them so full of steroids and hormones that the current government of Germany had to authorize a special compensation fund for the hundreds of retired East German athletes now beset by debilitating health problems. Thanks to leaked Soviet medical records, we now know that the absolutely dominating performance of Team USSR in the 1980s was also helped along by state-sponsored access to steroids. This isn't to say that there weren't vast stores of athletic talent in this general part of the world. The 2016 Olympics were held 25 years after the fall of communism, and yet you still saw incredible showings from former Soviet republics such as Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and of course Russia. But I'm afraid the moral here is that if you want to build a solid national Olympic team, you can either build a prosperous country where your citizens have the freedom and means to independently pursue athletic excellence, or you can build a poor totalitarian country where the only way to avoid an ignominious life in a gray apartment block is to submit to a state-sponsored athletics machine that may or may not pump you full of drugs.